Hey, let's do it to it. Just one second. Now we're back, and away we go, right into tactics. Thinking either queen c6 check, pawn takes c6, b7, king d7. I move the rook, queen takes takes. Or is it rook f d1? Or is it a b? Is it a 2 d? I'm thinking it's a d. This rook here. I have a question. Why not this? That's mate. Because in this scenario, if takes here, he could just grab that. Okay. It's all based on that move. Gotcha. It's all about the protection. Bishop takes, rook takes, and we're good to go. Gotta slow down here and make sure that I'm seeing what I need to see. Okay, queen d3. Bishop takes. So check, king moves. Bishop here. If the king moves, we just grab the bishop. But I don't understand. Why doesn't this work here? Oh, queening. I did not see the queen there. I was so blinded by my idea that I didn't see the queen. I do want to see the continuation though. That does puzzle me. So that's mate. Okay, whoops. That was cool. Knight takes pawn. Queen takes, bishop takes, and we're up a whole piece. Because what happens if at this point here, I'll show you. It comes here, you go. Interesting. So that move, what's it threatening? The pawn on d4. What did it move away from? The protection. So potentially we could actually take a knight. Bishop takes. Do we have anything after that? Potentially bishop e3 might be an idea, but no, because then the knight could take. So I should have went in the gut. I'll do that next time. I'll go in my gut on that. And I will do it next time. Had the right idea, just should have taken with the queen. Too slow. Right idea though. So that's not, I don't consider that a loss. I consider that a learning thing. I just need to be more aggressive sometimes. More aggressive. Check, and then I could pick up the rooks. There we go. Rook takes, double check here. Check. Thank you. takes. And like they're threatening that. Okay. Rook takes, queen takes, knight check. King F2, rook takes, rook takes. There's a king F2. If rook takes, we grab the queen. So rotates, check. King up, then we have a check there. Should have seen that. The tactic. Check. So checks. I mean, check. Bishop takes. Rook takes. King there. Just to stop that spot. Say rook e3, rook checks there. I see. Right here, rook checks here, and then we can do a Lucinda. So it takes the rook, rook takes, queen takes, there. Takes queen. And the king comes up, we check. It goes back, then we pick up, and we can pick it up, and we don't have to even sack our rook in that line. See if takes on G7, Bishop takes, and then we take, then a rook. Say queen check, king comes forward, then we checkmate with the rook. But if he pushed the pawn, then we'd still checkmate. Pound, boom. We have to just keep our minds intact and just keep pushing forward. Don't let down 1 minute. Right, I missed the plain old fork. I was trying to go for mate, so can't let that happen. Taking queen h3, and then we can actually push the pawn. So bishop takes a knight. Queen takes, and then we check, and then we have the bishop mate. Ah, drat. Let's pick up a queen. Oh, that's not fun. Should have picked up a queen there. No. Takes bishop. I check, king takes. Knight f5. King g4. Try to see if rook takes h6, king takes h6. Ooh, that does win. Should have shut that down and then came over here. Drat, okay. Okay. I'm trying to figure out if we play queen takes e6, g takes e6, all right, g takes e5. But we really can't. It's g takes f5 is the move that sinks the boat. King H7. Let's see here. See here. Hey, how you doing? Let me see here. What are we missing here? I'm looking at potentially, I'm changing my focus to something over here. Maybe there's something to do with, yeah, I was looking at that. The only problem is the bishop could take at that point. F7. Not bad. The only problem is we don't have enough counterplay after everything, though. Maybe if we do it right away, but no. Rook, only reason, rook F3, yeah. Trying to figure out is, see, rook f3, bishop takes knight. Pawn takes, and then queen goes to, say, e7. I don't really see any continuation for us. Well, if we did h6, we would lose. Yeah. I'm trying to see if potentially queen h7 might not be a bad move. That double that attacks the knight and the but I don't know. I'm not sure if that's even a good move though. I'm trying to see potentially if bishop c1, then bishop f4 might not be a good move, because we can then check at that point with G6. Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Whoa. Nice find there. Wow, should have seen that. That was straight in your face. So it takes, I push, takes. I knew we had to get the knight involved somehow, but drat. I have to keep on task. Taste check there, there, and then we got him. There we go, there we go. We're back in it. Back in it. twins trapped. Nice. Okay, do an unrated. I'll be right back. You guys talk through this, find it, and then we'll go over it. So feel free to put any information you want in on this puzzle here, and we'll work through it. Okay, so you're thinking E takes F, E takes F check, King takes F, and then Queen C4. So E takes F7, King takes F7. takes the knight check. Rook takes queen g6 check. King moves back, and do we have really anything after that? Well, we could play rook takes rook. I know for a surety that's the start. Now I'm trying to find the move sequence of is rook takes e7 an idea? Just to remove the guardian of g6. So queen c4. Nice. Well, let's see the continuation of that. Those are just some sublines, but the best line is actually this right here, the one we chose. Gives us a 7-pawn advantage. Thinking king here, but the only problem, king f3, wherever he goes he checks and moves in front. Actually, this is the idea. King f3, if king g1, rook g7 check, King f1, and then rook g2. Rook e, rook b, e, a check, king d6, e5 check, and then he runs. But if we go rook f, e8, and we then can actually trap the king. Well, let me see here. Hold on. There. Oh, we actually win a piece with that. I'll be dang. Okay. Rook e1. Queen, bishop here, bishop to f6. If bishop takes, rook takes, pawn takes, then we pick up the bishop. Take a break really quick and we'll watch some games. Let's take a quick break. Get a little bit of game knowledge in play. Okay, let's take a look at what this player's doing. I do a rapid. You could do a classic, but that's 15 minutes. And if I was playing, I'd do 15 or above. But just for analysis purposes right now, we're just going to look at a 10-minute one. But I wouldn't play a 10-minute one. You have to play higher level, longer games to get better. Let me see here. That's what I was looking at. I think he picks a pawn up in that line. Except, no, he could play one of his rooks over. Oh, he's going for the bishop. Nice. But I still think that bishop here is a good move, though. Bishop e4 is a killer move. Yeah. That threatens a discovery attack to win a pawn, or maybe even a whole piece in that line. Mainly a pawn. He can get his pawn back with interest. He might try rook b8, though. This might be an idea that White might want to look into, rook b8 with a pin. That if knight, if knight goes there, he then can take. And he could come up. That might be another idea. Ooh, so he's playing there. Now, then most definitely a take's gonna arise. And then king takes. So we predicted basically everything that our opponent was gonna do. Except, he kind of... Yeah, ouch. So he traded two pieces for a bishop and a knight. So it's an equal material, but I favor actually black here. That's just me. I think black has a better position. Because what white can actually do is play potentially a bishop move here. Attack this pawn when the pawn pushes, then he can actually cement potentially his bishop right here, cause a pretty big of a headache. It clogs up a pretty vital hole. One of these holes is going to come under fire. Oops. One of these holes will. So we have to plug it. Or he could leave it there and then just push. Maybe pushing was best. Yeah, now that I think about it. Bring a knight, put your knight there, but... Maybe you can actually move the king in that line. This is a tough one. Because you gotta be really careful. You don't want to get, you don't want something like this to happen to you. Be dropped right on your face. I think king moves best. But he's going to try to infiltrate in this way. And so what we'd have to do is actually jam a knight in on e8 just to hold the position. It may go towards it. Well, if you do that after the rook infiltrates in here, whoa, I don't like that move. I do not prefer that. That move's not. No. do you flip the board? Oh, there you go. That was a blunder. Wow. Black dodged a huge bullet there. Now black can get their pawns flowing down the board. Yeah, the that move that he played was losing, because now when this rook comes and he tries to do a check, this bishop could pick it up. Yikesies. This still is a very hard position to do, because if you notice that white has a lot of pawns that are just like headaches. They're big time headaches for black, because he's got two passers. Even if they are doubled, they're still a pain in the drain. What's gonna have to happen is we're gonna have to play F, and then we're gonna, oh good, he's clogging up the, oh nice, he's gonna try to get his pawns off rolling. Nice, get your pawns going, come on. Yeah, let's get them a rolling. I don't know if that, oh wow, he was very blessed. That would have shut the whole position down, and then black would be in a pretty big sitch. I now again prefer, this is the strange thing, I prefer black again. Before I preferred white. Yeah, black's gonna win this. He's just too strong, unless if he doesn't lose on time. I think he's got enough time. He's got a minute, and he could actually. I'd kind of go full throttle with that. Well, I don't know. I don't know. Yeah, and then I believe we could potentially get, well, the only problem is the king now barricades this, and it's a headache. That pawn's gonna fall. That was kind of a mistake. I guess not. It did give him room to breathe, didn't it? Wow, he bailed out of a lost position. Close to a lost position. Still isn't one yet. He's gonna have to play knight here. Still isn't a draw yet. Actually, white, you know what the weird thing is? I again prefer a white. This is kind of crazy. If he takes the knight, white loses. Because it's too fast up the board. So black again is winning. Oh wow. I gotta tell you, this was a great game. It's a draw. Wow. Wow. White bailed out of that. Wow. Now he's gonna try to see if he can't time. Yeah. Wow, that was something else right there. You have to love those type of battle positions like that. I was thinking about something like this. So it is losing. Okay, back to work. That was a pretty interesting game, to say the least. We'll do the Scotch game. We'll go over the Scotch game here, okay? This is another subline of the Scotch, with black playing bishop to c5. And there's a couple different lines that, like, I think we already went over last time. You could actually take, if you took here, this is a line you have to play there. And then there's two different ways that you could take. You could take here. If you wanted to play kind of slightly inferior, which you don't want to, that this has actually happened in a game too. And then white's stuck with these ugly pawns. So, knight g. And we went over this move here. And that happens back here, and the whole point is shutting this up, shutting that off, so that the bishop can come back. He castled. See, the whole point of this is we're eyeballing f7, and we could be potentially preparing to go e5, our castle ourself, and then f4, and then start some pretty big infiltration on the king side. So castles and then castles. And you're probably wondering, why did he play this? If he plays something like this here, I guess he could. This potentially could be a line, but look at the pawn structure. It's not very nice, but let's say you didn't know that, and you thought about, I want to stop the bishop from coming in here to attack. This actually could arise at this point. And I still think we're okay. After queen takes takes, now we have this massive pawn center, and it's pretty intense. So that's kind of why, and so to cover any of that type of, you know, not goodness, the bishop just retreated back to b6 and is saying, you know what, I'm safe. I know I lost the move, but I still have this attack. Knight c2, and white's like, just take it, and then I look how good my knight is now. And now I have this to enter, that to enter, all sweetness. So d6, knight d4, 2, bishop e6, and then queen 2, h5. Queen h5 is huge. Because now what you're threatening to do is to potentially get these pawns rolling down the board. G6, G3. And the idea is to get the F pawn actually after we take, after this here. And if we took here, he took there. We have, I gotta take here first, takes, and then play here, and we almost got the knight trapped. His knight's almost trapped. So white's slightly better here. So this is an equal position at this point. So nobody wins, nobody loses. They're all in this together. Alrighty. Well, we'll do a couple more puzzles. Okay, dokie. Takes. Oh. So how we're doing? Perfect. So we check on E8, moves up. Check. Do one more puzzle and Rook F6, check. King takes F6. Rook F8, check. King E6, Rook F6, check. King takes, and then Queen would check. King F, Rook F7. Do one more and we'll get this one right. queen takes a4. Bishop takes e4. Queen takes e4, and then we pick up a pawn. That's the only way to keep in contact with the bishop. See, knight check. One more, come on, come on, come on. Let's see here. Thinking about bishop e4 check. If queen c2, rook Rook takes c2, check, king takes c2, and then rook takes e7. Let's do one more. Queen takes f3, queen takes e5, check, and then king takes the bishop. Perfect, we'll stop there. You guys got any questions? Give you guys 1 minute on this puzzle or the Scotch game or anything you'd like to talk about that involves the Scotch or puzzles. Just in case. Alright. Well, guys, I wanted to thank you for logging on and spending your time. Remember, it's never a time wasted when you're studying and improving in chess, and that's just how, it sometimes feels like. Is it ever gonna end? No, because chess is fun. It's when you dive even deeper into chess, it's like a whole world opens up to you. Those pieces become alive. You are the king, you are the ruler, and you dictate if your soldiers live or if your soldiers die by your decision. That's what happens. So you have ultimate power. So that's why to be a good king, would want to study up and find out where you can improve and get better. And that's how study comes in, and practice. And they even did it during the medieval times. The knights had to be prepared in season and out of season all the time. They would train in the morning and evening, and I should say morning, afternoon, evening, so that the day that their king called on them, they'd be ready and fit to sally ho and take on the enemy for the kingdom. And we need to have that type of an understanding in chess, that we have a firm grip. And that's why doing puzzles are really important, and some opening repertoire is really good. If you're wondering if there's some good streams out there, Ginger GM, our Grandmaster Simon Williams, is a really good opening. He has a website. He has some games that, I mean, some openings. If you guys wanted to look into that, he's got some really good ones. I've been studying the French, the Killer French 1 and Killer French 2 recently, so that I can get beefed up on my French defense. So if you're interested in a lot, any like some different types of openings, he can set you up with some good ones, some downloadable ones. And there's nothing like when you can see it, when you can see that line and you see it in your head and you go boom 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 and you get it. Oh man, it's heaven sent. And as the most important thing, we're honoring the Lord with our gifts, which is our mind. So we gotta keep always that in first perspective, that he's the reason for the season. And you know what? Like what Bruce Lee said, there are no limits. There are plateaus, and we must go beyond that. And I know we can. I know you guys can go beyond them. We can know, and we can apply, and we can be willing, and I know we can do it. 'Cause you guys, you my chess cruncher friends, already proved it when you found some puzzles, really sweet puzzles, like that queen takes f7, and then king takes, a knight takes, and then the knight actually does a mate. You gotta love that type of a setup. And you, my friends, you guys saw it, so that was cool. We just have to remember, though, in the end, what is the legacy that you'll leave behind? Like Rheinfeld and Horowitz wrote books. Yasser, Jeremy Silliman wrote books and did DVDs as well. And if it's what will you leave behind for the next generation? That's why the Lord has given me this gift of chess, so that I can teach and share the knowledge that my teacher gave me with you, my chess friends, to improve. So his legacy lives on through me. And so when my chess friends, keep when you guys win and you guys get a title like an NM or IM or a GM or an FM or one of those titles, don't forget to write a book or a blog or something to leave how you got to where you were behind for the next generation to improve, and it helps chess. So just some friendly advice from your friend Chess Cruncher. So, and remember what we say: coal under pressure becomes a diamond, and a sword that sharpened could defend and protect. So we have to keep that in mind. A sword is what's our mind. We have to keep it sharper than any two-edged sword. And we have to also, because our eyes are a window to our soul, we have to keep them focused on the board and not distracted when we're playing. so that we can play a good game, and then afterwards, when we win or draw, either one, we go to the Skittles, and we can then you can teach and leave a legacy with a player that they could take that back, and they can apply it to their game, and they can the player can improve right alongside with you, because your opponent might have actually seen something that you missed maybe 5 or 6 moves back, and you saw something that he missed, so you both can improve. And that's sharing the love of chess, in my opinion. So I will leave you guys with, oh yes, and can you say prayer for Paris? It's in great turmoil right now, Francis. There's a lot of chaos going on. Pray for the families that they're safe over there, and that there's healing, and that they find, you know, an equal ground, so nobody gets hurt anymore there. I appreciate you guys doing that. And as Wesley so says, through the Lord Jesus, as I say, God bless, and I'll see you guys next time on Chess Cruncher TV. Have a blessed morning, afternoon, and evening. Lord willing, I'll be back on tomorrow, and we'll do some more Scotch game, for Black, the C5, Bishop C5 variation of the Scotch game. And remember, I almost forgot to throw this in, we do it every night, is this. We hang up our coat, we hang up our hat, and we study when most won't, we do. And that makes all the difference. Congratulations, great job. We're rising up in the ratings again. Had a couple bumps here and there. So you know what? You're not going to get out of chess understanding without a couple of bruises here and there. But guess what? Those heal, you learn, and then you're able to apply them. So great job. Go Team Chess Cruncher. Hoorah. Great job. Keep pushing forward. Be blessed, and I'll see you guys tomorrow. Bye-bye.